Checkpoint Theatre presents Vulnerable, written and performed by Cheyenne Alexandria Phillips, dramaturged and directed by Huzir Sulaiman, with music and sound design by Shah Tahir. 8. The Next Right Thing.
City-state confidence. The state narrative is a broken record. We had nothing, and yet we are here. It is a song carved into our bones, embedded into us by our own conviction. We repeat it now, forgetting how rich we have become, arrogant in how capable we are. The full refrain actually is, we had nothing, and yet we are here. But beware, we can have nothing again. When the world fell into peril, our leaders said, if anyone can get out, we can. And global experts said, if they can't get out, no one else can. This is confidence in chaos. It is strange how sure a people can be of themselves when they sing of accomplishment and doubt in the same breath. A new type of planning. I've been bullet journaling for more than 3 years now. It's a system of planning in an empty notebook that allows you to keep track of everything you need to do. In its purest form, it's a customizable system that you build yourself. At the Instagram level, it is aesthetically overwhelming. I took up the system because I freelance. I needed to know when I needed to be at the live animal park, billion-dollar flower land, or rehearsals. My engagements were color coordinated. I tracked finances, invoices, and spending. It made my growing to-do list feel less overwhelming. When everything started getting cancelled, the biggest joke in the bullet journal community was that setting up their notebooks for 2020 was a stupid idea. The planner became the most useless thing anyone needed right now. But the bullet journal system is a flexible system. So when 2020 cancelled everything, I had to rethink how I would plan my life, if I could even do that. For some reason, I decided to do the most terrible thing imaginable. I wrote down all the daily case numbers in Singapore for the month of April. Superb choice. It was depressing, to say the least. Something I had used to plan for the future was now documenting the devastation of the present. I felt like I was wasting pages if I didn't do anything with it. After a while, I started writing the phrase, "Stop the glorification of busy," in my journal. I don't know when I started writing it exactly, but it was proving helpful. I used it to remind myself to stop worrying that the world kept moving while I was here, stagnant, stationary, waiting for a comeback. Stop the glorification of busy. Just because I'm not running around the island doesn't mean I'm unengaged. Stop the glorification of busy. Just because work is slow doesn't mean I'm not working. Stop the glorification of busy. Just because it doesn't look like effort doesn't mean it isn't. It's still difficult, but I am slowly realizing what were the distractions in my life. I am realizing that there are companies and people who will take care of me and wait for me, and there are those who won't. There are engagements I don't need to return to because I've learned all that I could from them. The terrible thoughts about work and income creep back sometimes, less often than they used to. Sometimes when I'm watching friends get promotions or job raises or career changes, even in a pandemic, they come back. When I think the world is turning without me, they come back. I change how I plan life now. I don't. I draw up some usual setups. I make a monthly calendar and track my finances. I check on my self-care now too. That setup is new. But I don't draw out the whole month in the way I used to. Each day with its own designated space, predetermining its potential. I take the time to add a new day every evening. I I literally take it one day at a time. It's been really helpful. There's no predetermined anything. Some days I make lists. Some days I comment on the happenings in the world. Some days I do something extra. A drawing or a poem. Or I'll stick a photograph in. Or write a 3-page journal entry. Maybe that is all I am meant to do in this time. Bear witness to the chaos in the world. Not try to make sense of it. Filling in what I need to fill in, what I want to fill in, offers me some relief. It makes me feel resilient. I might want to jump away like a frog, but at least I jump to fill in empty pages. It makes me feel like I have resilience. I may not be as strong as steel beams on ships, but maybe I'll be as sturdy as book spines. Flexible enough to catch all the realizations the pandemic had to offer. Vaccines, 25th April 2021. You booked the place with the Pfizer, right?
Yes, Mom.
Okay, good. Don't take Moderna.
Why?
My mother doesn't answer me. She kind of just gives a look that says, "Why do you dare ask this question?" I then get interrogated on why I couldn't get the vaccine at the same place and on the same day as my mother's second jab. For this, I push the blame to the Ministry of Health. It's not my fault we couldn't line up the appointments. It is a Sunday afternoon when I go down to receive my first dose.
Oh, you are early, you know.
Yeah, I thought there would be a line. The lady registering me looks at the empty multi-purpose hall. She says, "No lah, won't have a line." Like I should have known that. She takes a few minutes to register me, going through the list of questions they are required to ask. Are you allergic to anything? No. Are you or do you suspect that you are pregnant? No. Do you have any medical conditions? Yes, I have a heart condition. I present a letter from my cardiologist explaining I am fit to take the vaccine. She doesn't take it. My answer is sufficient enough for her to do her job. It takes a few minutes to register, and getting a needle stuck in your arm happens faster than snapping your fingers. The only time I am offered to sit and contemplate is during the 30 minutes observation. It is all a little too anticlimactic. Maybe because it is happening in a time when Singapore is relatively safe. My country is generally more open now. Case numbers in the community remain low. People have adapted to the new normal. Maybe I have too. I don't know why, but I hoped getting vaccinated would fix things. Or at least, change things. This is supposed to be the part in the series where Ross and Rachel stop fooling around and get together for real, and we all get closure and a happy ending. But as mRNA is coursing through my body, and I turn into a statistic of people who have taken the vaccine, I recognize that the place I am writing from is privileged. I don't have to look too far to know that. Just across the border, the number of cases is skyrocketing. Malaysia is in a state of emergency. Around the world, there are concerns about unequal distribution of the vaccine. Public systems are failing. Doctors are at their wits' end. A lot of people are suffering in a way I cannot understand. My sister has to wait her turn, just like other peers in my age group. It wasn't COVID she had at the beginning of the year, thankfully. Hopefully, with vaccinations, COVID will be easier to rule out as a cause for a fever. Some friends have been turned away at vaccination centres,
due to concerns of allergic reactions. There are some risks I can take that others won't be allowed to. Meanwhile, there are still people spreading rumors, trying to discredit the vaccine. And they will use any symptom they can to do so. Hair loss? Vaccine. Toothache? Vaccine. Sprained ankle? Vaccine. Frostbite? Vaccine. I hear my name being announced, and I'm seen at the discharge counter by a kid with bluish-purple hair. I am sure he is 10 years younger than me. He doesn't value add to the experience. He's printing some follow-up information while I am thinking about how we move on from here. Don't forget your free gift when you leave. Wow, on top of the vaccine being free, now I got free gift also ah. Turns out, I'll be armed with a box of masks and a 500ml bottle of hand sanitizer, regardless of how I choose to move in the world. Memorials. Dad and I take an impromptu drive to Country War Memorial. It's incredibly quiet, peaceful, and solemn. There is another family visiting, and some gardeners working the grounds. There is no evidence of a pandemic here. This would be my first time to Kranji War Memorial. Dad's been here before, once or twice, just to sit and look around. Today he finds a box with books in it. They are lists of the names of the men and women that are honored here. For fun, he turns to P. Phillips. We aren't expecting anything. At most a distant relative. Someone I won't know. The names of the dead are together with the names of their parents, where they lived, when they died, and their age at death. I recognize my great-grandmother's name very quickly. Her son is here somewhere. Dad is surprised. He confirms the address of their old house. He sends a picture to his sibling's WhatsApp chat. We visit the place where my granduncle's initials are carved and sit for a while. According to the book, he was 16 years old when he died. He wasn't. He was 14. He lied about his age to meet the minimum requirement to join the volunteer corps. I'm thinking about this now because I've come to realize that Singapore probably won't have a memorial for all we have lost in COVID-19. No memorial, no day of remembrance, no communal marker. There wasn't one for the Spanish flu, despite the apparent death toll being 3 times that of the First World War. There isn't one for SARS 2003, despite it being part of our recent history. I don't expect there to be one for COVID-19. Maybe in some cities and countries where the death toll is a sad and scary number, but not here. We are waiting for the world to go back to normal because we are expecting it to pass, like the flu or any other virus. We think if the world stays in bed for 2 weeks, it will be over. That is us, being optimistic. As of the day of this recording, there have been over 3.2 million deaths. I am grateful that we are not reaching the numbers of the World Wars or the Spanish flu. But that's nothing to be optimistic about. 3.2 million people died. Without a public memorial, the grief of their loss will be a private affair. They weren't brave in the face of danger. They didn't volunteer to fight in a war. They didn't die so that we could be free. As a world, our narrative of these lost lives is just that. They are lost. Our greatest sorrow will be that we will have nowhere to sit and remember them. Courage. Years ago, when we all could congregate, you'd be able to find me every third Thursday at Blue Jazz, reading in an open mic night, pouring emotions into a badly written poem. It really didn't matter how terrible it was. The point was to get on the small platform of a stage, be blinded by lights as hot as the surface of the sun, wondering why you are not up there with a drink. You can see bodies of an audience. You know they will have opinions of you. And you still read your shit sonnet anyways. I used that platform to try and write about my heart condition, about what it means to live with it. I did so unsuccessfully. The metaphors were terrible. I called myself a broken doll at one point. Scars and all. When I got off the stage, three fellow poets engulfed me in the greatest hug of all time. If the pandemic did anything, it overexposed the world to the fragility of our lives. Countries around the world are coming to terms with the flaws in their healthcare systems, their insurance coverage, the way the poor are treated. In Singapore, we took for granted our migrant workers, the ones that helped put together the flats we will all struggle to afford. It poked holes in business operations, sinking various enterprises. It forced people to question their purpose. They called artists non-essential. It's been a while. And I still have an issue with that. It was unkind in a time when the world needed kindness. Even in chaos, some people only know how to kick you while you are down. I wish more people realized that artists are the best people to learn vulnerability from. When they share a work, a painting, a piece of writing, a performance, anything, there is a risk that the audience will love it or hate it. They could give you a standing ovation or boo you off the stage. Worse still, they could write scathing reviews. But it is only in art spaces, around arts people, where I have been thanked for my vulnerability. It is also the only space that the courage needed to be this vulnerable is acknowledged. Courage comes from the Latin word cor, which means of the heart. Courage originally meant to speak one's mind by telling all of one's heart. You have to be vulnerable to be courageous. You have to be open to criticism and harm if you want people to experience your story. It still terrifies me that this is out in the world. Just like it terrified me to read bad poems about broken doll people. But I still want to share this with you. Anything worth my passion is also worth my fear, right? Here's the question I have after sharing all this with you. If I were to offer you the remainder of my heart, how will I know you will treat it with care? Phase 2, Take 2. 5th May, 2021. Over the past 3 days, we have been in a recording studio. The situation has been developing outside the soundproof walls. New clusters have formed at Tan Tock Seng Hospital and ICA. Just yesterday, a new variant has been found, more contagious than the one that was introduced into the country a year ago. Restrictions have returned like an annoying auntie you cannot get rid of. The one that always sends good morning texts in every WhatsApp group she is in. I am now 11 days away from getting my second jab. Turns out that I can still be infected with or without it. They say the effects will not be as bad, but is that true for someone with a heart condition? I knew that writing about an ongoing pandemic would mean that something could happen and my story would change and there would be no closure. Because there is truth in the phrase, nobody is safe until everyone is safe. Until everyone is safe, we take what we can. Like long evening strolls with the family, Zoom calls until 2 a.m. with friends like Roxanne, or producing work like this. We are all in different boats, in the same storm. That doesn't mean we cannot navigate and travel together as a fleet. We take it one day at a time until we are all in safer waters together.
Vulnerable is developed and produced by Checkpoint Theatre. To support the creation of original Singapore work, please make a donation to Checkpoint Theatre at www.giving.sg. Checkpoint Theatre's Vulnerable, produced by Huzir Sulaiman and Claire Wong, written and performed by Cheyenne Alexandria Phillips, dramaturged and directed by Huzir Sulaiman, sound engineering, music and sound design by Shah Tahir, production stage manager is Sumono, assistant dramaturg Mao Yen Tay, marketing and publicity by Lum Ishawn and Jane Lim, additional support by Nicole Wong. If you have the time, we would love to hear from you. Please give us your feedback by following the link in this episode's description.